The earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, the people and those who dwell in it. Today, as we begin these sacred ceremonies, we acknowledge that Providence rests on lands occupied over many centuries by the Cree and Anishinaabe peoples, joined later by the Métis. Their descendants are to be found in the Red River Métis and, closest to us, the Rosa River Anishinaabe First Nation community. It is within their territory that our activity as a Christian educational institution takes place, under Treaty 1, signed in 1871. We honor them as current hosts and original trustees of this part of God's creation. May we live well in the land together. Let us pray. Almighty God, as we stand in awe of your goodness and mercy today, we invite you to be present amongst us by the power of your Holy Spirit. Father, we declare that we love you. Thank you that you have made the way of love known through your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that you would reveal this great love to us all today as we gather to celebrate the graduation of these many students. Lead us by your Spirit to praise you. May our hearts overflow with thanksgiving, and our mouths proclaim your everlasting greatness. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. On behalf of the Board of Governors, President Johnson, the faculty and staff of Providence University College and Theological Seminary, I would like to welcome you to the 2021 graduation ceremony. I would like to extend a special welcome to the graduating class of April 2020. You have had to wait longer than most for this time, but we are glad that you are here with us to celebrate today. This has been a strange year. I think that's an understatement. It's been a very strange year. All of us, in our own ways and in our own places, have had to deal with circumstances and situations and limitations such as we have never faced before. We had hoped that this would be a year filled with students on campus teaching face-to-face in classrooms. It turns out that that was not to be so. Many of you have spent your entire year staring through a camera lens into a virtual classroom. I want to begin by thanking you, our students, for the incredible level of faithfulness that you have shown over this past year in attending classes, interacting with your fellow students, completing assignments, and staying true to your vision and goals for your education. I want to say thank you to the faculty who over the last 18 months have had to reconfigure all of their teaching just to make this graduation a possibility. A lot of that work has happened in the background. It has been done quietly in home offices, in solitude. But it has been done with incredible faithfulness, skill, and creativity. I am grateful to them for that work. I want to say thank you to the student life staff who made it possible for that small group of students who wished to live on campus to do so. It was challenging having to apply all of the health orders and regulations related to COVID-19. Again, I want to thank you for the grace and the patience and the humility that you showed over this past year. This, of course, is not the graduation that you might have hoped for. It's certainly not the graduation that we wanted to plan. But God has been good to us. God has brought us safely this far. And for that, we will offer the thankfulness and worship of this graduation celebration.
President Johnson, distinguished guests, faculty and staff, graduates, family of graduates, friends of Providence, welcome. Often at graduation ceremonies, the spirit of the occasion is that of having completed something, of having finished. For some of you, this day will officially bring your academic career to a close, done and dusted. For others of you, this day will mark the completion of the first degree, of which you will create a boxed set you will accumulate in your toolbox of life skills. Irrespective of how you see yourself, we treat these events as endings. Graduations are celebrated at the end of the academic year. There is an air of finality about this day. This feels like an ending. On behalf of the Board of Governors, and as your chair, the cabinet, faculty, and staff, we celebrate with you the success that you have achieved, which is memorialized on this day by receiving, if only virtually, the parchment marking this accomplishment. I would urge all graduates to celebrate what you have completed and the place to which this day has brought you. God has given strength, forbearance, and courage so that you could arrive at this day. It is important to pause and give thanks for God's grace and be remembering of how great is His faithfulness. I encourage you, in the midst of your revelry, lift your eyes beyond the horizon of this day to see today as not only an ending, but to also see this as a marker, a milestone along your way. Let me explain. The people of Israel in 1 Samuel chapter 7 had returned to the Lord, having confessed that they had sinned against Him. The prophet Samuel offered a burnt offering before the Lord on behalf of the people. At that point in the story, however, the Philistines came up to attack. The Lord spectacularly rescued the people of Israel from the Philistines. You may have also experienced sin, confession, and attack. The connection I draw to your attention is the rescue. When the battle was over, Samuel set up a stone that he named an Ebenezer, which means stone of help. Samuel spoke to the people and reminded them, "Thus far has the Lord helped us." I encourage you, as you celebrate this day, to mark this day as an Ebenezer, a reminder that thus far the Lord has helped you. If I might, I commend to you a habit of marking significant times and events as Ebenezers, for it is the Lord who gives strength and wins the battle in all that we do. There are many times when He carries us, and for the stubborn or strong-willed among us, He may have to drag us to the next marker. Today is an ending. I encourage you to proclaim it as an Ebenezer Day. I would invite you to consider a second image. Some of you have also experienced hardship, trials, loss during your time at or with or in Providence's care. These are all difficult. We don't like hardship. COVID is not the least or the greatest of our hardships. Our good God molds us and shapes us through hardship. The image I promote to you now is that of having become a seed. Seeds are small. They don't look particularly glorious. The outside does not reveal what the inside can do. You have been immersed in the rich soil of theology, spiritual care, and spiritual formation. Your outside does not reveal what the inside will do. From now on, God has the opportunity to transplant you to a new place for a new purpose. Growth, flowering, and fruit can come from this spiritual transplanting. May you yield a wondrous garden of spiritual gifts for the benefit of those you will serve and for the pleasure of our Lord. It is an honorable calling, that of serving. May you yield to God's invitation to serve. This day also marks another significant Ebenezer in the life of Providence University College and Theological Seminary. This day reminds us of the end point for the term of service by Dr. David Johnson, our president. President Johnson came to Providence 30 years ago as a professor of New Testament in the seminary. His service here has influenced thousands of students and faculty who will have an impact in our world. Neither President Johnson nor any of the students know what the extent and fruit that are born from his service. Students, faculty, staff, the boards of governance that guide this university and seminary have all benefited from the growth, flowering, and fruit that has resulted from President Johnson's service to this place. This day, while it comes with the sadness for the ending that it represents, is also a marker, an Ebenezer, in the life of this amazing institution that God has carried, as well as in President Johnson's life and the life of his family. The Board of Governors bids a fond adieu to this important service and extends its true admiration and sincere gratitude for the work you have wrought. We, as the Providence family, are proud to honor this day as an Ebenezer. We recognize it is the Lord who has led President Johnson and all of us. We mark this Ebenezer with the sure knowledge and conviction that our God will not abandon us. Before we turn to the graduation address, I urge to hear the words of the Lord as recorded for us in Mark 10, 35 to 45. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him. "Teacher," they said, "we want you to do for us whatever we ask." "What do you want me to do for you?" he asked. They replied, "Let us one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in your glory." "You don't know what you are asking," Jesus said. "Can you drink the cup I drink, or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with?" "We can," they answered. Jesus said to them, "You will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with. But to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared." When the 10 heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." And now, a proper introduction to our guest speaker at our commencement ceremonies. Dr. David Johnson is a graduate of the University of Minnesota, Dallas Theological Seminary, and Trinity International University. He came to Providence in 1990 to teach New Testament and Greek in the seminary. In 2000, he was appointed professor of New Testament. He became the dean of the seminary in 2002. In 2007, he was appointed provost and executive vice president for Providence University College and Theological Seminary. He has served as president since 2012. Prior to pursuing doctoral studies, he was pastor of Faribault Evangelical Free Church in Faribault, Minnesota for 7 years. He is married to Barb. They have 3 children and 8 grandchildren. Dr. Johnson will retire from the presidency at the end of June, after which he will be on sabbatical for 3 months. President Johnson, would you please serve us with the graduation address?
John Mark University College and Theological Seminary had many students and one teacher. And that teacher chose 12 of those students to become student leaders. He taught everyone, and then he would take the student leaders aside, and he would show them how to do leadership and how to do ministry. And then he would send them out, and they would practice. And then they would come back, and they would talk about their practice. And then he would teach them again, and then he would send them out, and then they would come back. And this happened for a period of about 3 years. He kept going and around in circles like this, and doing these things, and then it was time for the final exam and graduation. And they were getting ready to take that long march to the city of Jerusalem for that final exam. And just before that, there was one more opportunity to teach. And so Jesus found the perfect situation. The disciples were arguing with each other. Who's going to be first? Who's going to be greatest? Who's going to be the leader of this new movement that Jesus has started? And Jesus called them all aside, and he said, "You know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Not so with you. The world is different than life in this new movement, in this kingdom that Jesus was establishing." And so he said, "Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant." It was a strange thing in the ancient world to talk about servants and leaders together. In fact, Leonard Gopelt, in his book on apostolic times, says that they were never used together. Service and leadership were just almost opposite to one another. And then Jesus goes on and he says, "And whoever wants to be first must be the slave of all." And that's almost humorous, sort of like the camel going through the eye of a needle. Jesus was humorous here. He was saying, you know, in order to be first, you have to take the lowest place. In fact, below the lowest place. Slaves were considered to be looking up from at the bottom, from underneath. They were sometimes considered not even to be people, to be human. And Jesus is saying, if that's how you need to live your life, as you need to take this status of slave. At Providence, we are sending you out, graduates, with knowledge and character, and we're sending you out for leadership and service. And we very deliberately put the word service in our mission statement, because that's what distinguishes us as a theological or as an educational institution. We send people out not just for leadership, but for service. When I was first president, I went to a course, an executive leadership course at Queen's University. And one of the teachers was Julian Barling. And Julian Barling taught us about leadership, and he talked about transformational leadership. And when he was talking about transformational leadership, he wasn't just talking about transforming organizations, transforming businesses, transforming schools. He was talking about transforming people. And that's what transformational leadership is all about, the transformation of people's lives. And when he talked about transformational leadership, he said there are four characteristics. And I just want to talk about the first one. He called it idealized influence. Idealized influence. And what he meant by that was that the leader, the transformational leader, is a person who embodies the values and the mission of the organization. That's what idealized influence is all about. And that's what Jesus did as well. After talking to the disciples about their own leadership, he said this, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Jesus was the example, embodiment of what he was calling his disciples to be servants, to be servant leaders. Not to be first, not to be great, but to be servant leaders. Why do we do this? Why do we spend time in learning how to be a servant leader? In his great sermon, The Weight of Glory, C.S. Lewis answers that question in the last paragraph of the sermon. He says, first of all, that throughout the sermon, he's talking about this idea of glory. And he says, and I agree with him, and I've checked it out, and he's exactly right, that quite often, or almost half the time, the idea of glory in the New Testament, particularly in the Apostle Paul, is about God glorifying us. We usually think of glory as something that we do for God. We glorify God. But actually, in the New Testament, there's just as many passages that talk about God glorifying us, restoring us to glory. And so C.S. Lewis says that's the reason we do this kind of leadership, this weight of glory, as he calls it. He says this, "There are no ordinary people. You've never talked to a mere mortal. Nations and cultures and arts and civilizations, these are mortal. But it is immortals whom we joke with, work with, marry, snub, and exploit." The Apostle Paul says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. "Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. This is what God is doing. And in the context of this passage, it's talking about this restoration of glory in us, that God is working day by day inwardly to transform us into the image of His Son. Paul goes on and says, "For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal weight of glory." An eternal weight of glory. That's what God is doing, and He's doing it through the troubles and trials of life. And He uses leaders, like you are going out to be. He uses leaders to help this transformation process, this work of transformational leadership. "For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal weight of glory." So Paul says, we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Not on the outward, but on the inward. Since what is seen is temporary. The societies and the civilizations and the organizations that you will go and lead, they're all temporary. Providence has been here for almost 100 years now, and I'm hoping that it's going to be here for another 100 years. But eventually, it will disappear because it's temporary, it's temporal. It's things that are seen. But it is what is unseen, Paul says, that is eternal. And what is unseen is the inner person, the people that we work with. We never talk to a mere mortal, Lewis said. We are working and we're serving and we're leading people who are going to last forever. The most important thing in the world is people. And that is who God has called us to serve. We fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Amen.
Since 1925, Providence University College has been graduating more than 10,000 leaders with character and knowledge who serve in business, science, industry, and nonprofits in Canada and around the world.
I'm studying business because I want to make a difference by building strong relationships with people and clients in the business world.
I'm studying biology because I want to make a difference by researching ways to conserve our endangered wildlife.
I'm getting my master's in PT Soul because I wanted to make a difference by training students to become English teacher all around the world.
I'm studying psychology because I want to make a difference as a counselor, helping individuals and families going through personal problems.
I'm studying sociology because I want to make a difference by helping individuals who are vulnerable as a consequence of systemic injustice.
I am studying aviation because I want to make an eternal difference in the life of every student that sits in my cockpit, not just through flying, but also through equipping them for any calling God has given them.
Good day, Providence Cabinet, President Johnson, board members, faculty, staff, graduates, parents, families, friends, alumni, and special guests. Thank you all for joining us on this special occasion. While it may not be under the normal circumstances, it is still just as special and important in the lives of all the graduates here, and we appreciate you taking the time to attend. To my fellow graduates, we may not be gathered in person with all our friends and family to watch us walk across the stage as we would hope to, but I encourage you to not let that stop you from celebrating today. You have achieved an amazing accomplishment. You have pushed through all the late nights and the last-minute assignments, made it through a few too many stress-inducing exam weeks, and passed enough of your courses to be graduating here today. In all seriousness, take the time to celebrate today. This is an outstanding feat to have accomplished, and you should all be proud of yourselves. Congratulations. Now, this year has looked much different than that of previous years. We have struggled with having our classes online, the cancellation of our sports teams, the lack of in-person community, the community which Prov is so famously known for, and even motivation to complete our assignments. and I can attest to many examples of the latter. And for those of you who know me, they know that I am famous for leaving all of my assignments to the last minute. So on that note, while I was writing the speech last night, I was thinking about how different this year has been. It has changed a lot about not only our education, but about life in general. This year has been full of adversity for many. Many have lost their jobs or quit school, lost friends, family members, suffered from loneliness or broken relationships. While these things may have been more prominent this past year, they do happen all the time. We have the shared common experiences of losing a loved one, of navigating those broken relationships, of dealing with financial uncertainty or job loss. Name any other struggle that you've had, and there will be others who have faced similar. And as Christians, we are even promised that we will have to face adversity. Jesus promises to his disciples in John 16:33, saying that in this world you will have trouble. No matter where you are in life, you'll face adversity and go through trials and struggles. Now, I know this may seem like a bit of a depressing start to, a speech that is supposed to motivate all my fellow graduates to go out and conquer the world, but I want to share something with you that I've learned through my struggles and adversity. I've heard it said that a lesson learned should be a lesson shared. So I wish to share with you all this lesson. This past year, I have faced much adversity and gone through many trials. And in the midst of one of my most recent struggles, I was reading a book in which the author talks of adversity and references the book of James, specifically James 1. In James chapter 1, verse 2, the author states that we should consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds. Now, I don't know about you, but I definitely do not consider it joyful when I'm going through adversity. I far too often find myself complaining or stressing about how hard life is or that I'm not going to be able to make it through this. And trials are tough. They drain us mentally and physically. So why then should we consider it pure joy to go through them? James answers this question in his following verses. He writes, "Because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance, let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything." Now, I've read this verse many times before, but this time around, it felt like a switch flipped in my head. And all of a sudden, I had a clearer understanding of what it meant. It meant that I need to go through adversity to grow and mature, to produce perseverance. And after this, I saw this theme everywhere. People who I talked to about my struggles advised me to remember that God will use my adversity to strengthen me, to produce perseverance within me. I saw it in devotionals and in sermons quite regularly. And all centers around the theme of God using our trials to mold and shape us into who He planned for us to be. So, no matter where you go in life or what you do, you are guaranteed to face adversity. But we can take heart because Jesus has overcome the world, as he states after the promise of the trials in John 16:33. We can have faith and trust that God is using our struggle to mold us into who he planned for us to be. Our struggles and pain refine us into the people whom God has planned for us to be. With each struggle and trial, we need to rely on God to make it through. And with his help, we come one step closer to who he created us to be. And we can certainly be joyful about that. In closing, I wish to leave you with a poem written by Dale Martin Stone. The poem is entitled "The Shaping of a Disciple," and it reads, "When God wants to drill a man and thrill a man and skill a man, when God wants to mold a man to play the noblest part, when he yearns with all his heart to create so bold a man that the whole world will be amazed, watch his methods, watch his ways. How he ruthlessly perfects whom he royally elects, how he hammers him and hurts him, and with mighty blows converts him into trial shapes of clay, which only God can understand. While his tortured heart is crying, and he lifts beseeching hands, how God bends but never breaks when his good he undertakes. How he uses whom he chooses, and with every purpose fuses him, by every act induces him to try his splendor out. God knows what he's about. So, graduates, as you go forth from Providence to pursue your dreams and goals and follow God's plan for your life, may you consider it pure joy when you face trials, because you know that God is using them to shape you and mold you. The same applies to every one of us. No matter who or where we are, may we rely on God and take heart in adversity, and trust that God will create perseverance within us and use those trials to mold us and shape us into who he has created us to be. Thank you.
We are excited to recognize all of our University College graduates today, including those who have earned a certificate or diploma. Well done. Dr. Johnson, the following candidates, having presented Manitoba senior matriculation or its equivalent, having successfully completed the required program of studies, having shown willingness and faithfulness in field education assignments, having displayed diligence in the Christian life, and as such having completed the stated graduation requirements of Providence University College, are hereby recommended for the following degrees: Associate of Arts, Bachelor of Arts, Bachelor of Science, Bachelor of Business Administration, Bachelor of Theology, and Master of Arts.
By the authority of the Board of Governors of Providence University College, and by the right of the Charter of the Province of Manitoba, I hereby present the Associate, Bachelor, and Master's degrees with all the honors, rights, and privileges attached thereto.
My name is Catherine Rastakimbalaji, and as University College Dean, it is my honor to present the Bachelor of Arts degrees. The Bachelor of Arts degrees include majors in Aviation, Biblical and Theological Studies, Church Ministries, Communications and Media, General Studies, Humanities, Intercultural Studies, Psychology, Social Sciences, Sociology, TESOL, and Youth Leadership. These graduates have truly grown in knowledge and character for leadership and service. Graduates, we congratulate you and we are so proud of you. And we eagerly await hearing how you are making a difference in your communities around the world. Maxim Borodin, Keegan Braun, Yunjun Chui, Yujin Chui, Alina Collier, Rebecca Desarmian, William Dewick, Jenna Enns, Kyla Fast, Laura Friesen, Isaac Ginter, Julia Gertson, Alexandra Graf, Oriana Henzerski, Crystal Heppner, Rihanna Hodges, Ethan Hoekstra, Joshua Hoogerdijk, Ara Cho, Daphne Kaler, Sohyun Kim, Bryce Clausen, Morgan Krogstad, Leighton Krogstad, Carla Lane, Seungho Lee, Yein Lee, Dylan Lind, Naomi McMillan, Donna Michael, Scott Moyer, Noble Okonkwo, Hyunjin Park, Marigold Peters, Tyson Plett, Daehoon Suk, Selena Skoroborhac, Kyle Smith, Jian Song, Shinsuk Song, Rebecca Stevenson, Jay Thielman, Bethany Towett, Hannah Van Shee, Devin Vermette, Bethany Visser, Megan Weeb, Madison Will, Ryan Wirch, Tokozani Zimba.
Hello, I am Rebecca Dale Schneider, the Assistant Professor of Biology in Providence University College, and I have the honor today of presenting our Bachelor of Science graduates. Science is the newest program in the University College. It began in 2016 and has grown to include 5 qualified educators, including myself, that teach our 26 science courses, of which 12 include wet labs. Our science students grow their passions for people, animals, and the environment. They expand their knowledge and hone their skills in research, experimentation, and communication. Last year, in 2020, we saw our very first science graduates, and we are so pleased to see more students this year complete their Bachelor of Science degree. To our science graduates, well done. I am so proud of you. I have seen you accomplish great things over the years, and I have no doubt that you will continue to see success as you move forth from this place. Congratulations. Charisma Ginter. Darby Holden. Marissa Nosiar. Esther Rushagiza. Caitlin Workentine. Claire Yager.
My name is Dr. Jeremy Funk. I am Associate Professor of Business and Director of the Buller School of Business at Providence University College. Today I have the honor of presenting our business graduates. The business program is the largest program at the University College when it comes to students majoring in a specific undergraduate degree. The fall of 2020 also registered the highest number of credit hours taught since our revamped business program began in 2015. We offer 3 primary business program configurations: a 2-year Associate of Arts in Business, a 3-year Bachelor of Arts with a major in Business Administration, and a 4-year Bachelor of Business Administration. Each of these programs is designed to equip students with entry-level knowledge, skills, and character needed for effective service in administration and leadership functions in business and not-for-profit organizations. Graduates continue to demonstrate skills acquisition. The field of business is broad, but the abilities obtained are valuable in many different contexts. Students have developed skills for application in management, in team development, and communications. They continue to integrate their faith. They face this challenge of bringing faith and business together through practical application. And they also continue further higher business education, such as the MBA and the CPA. To our business graduates, you make us proud of what you have achieved, and we look forward to seeing how you will make a difference in the world of business. Congratulations. Muhammad Ashraf. Thomas Copeland. Jeffrey Duick. James Lee Lewis. Hamza Wahid. Randolph Coez Lucas. Kyle Duick. Corinne Fernanda Hall Venske. Clark Noctical. Amelia Reimer. Pierce Dresser. Lindsay Duick. Cody Erickson. Zachary Friesen. Jonathan Fulford. Carlos Octavia Herrera Lagaria. Curtis Hoffer. Braden Owen. Jordan Peters. Chantel Reimer.
My name is Dr. Heather Mackenberg. I am the Associate Professor of Biblical Studies here at Providence University College. Today I have the privilege of presenting the Bachelor of Theology. Congratulations on reaching this milestone. Ryan McMahon.
It is my honor as University College Dean to present the Master of Arts degrees. Providence University College began to offer a Master's in TESOL and TTESOL in 2015. Our MA students have gone on to teach and train teachers in Canada, the United States, China, Japan, South Korea, Kuwait, Nigeria, the Congo, Paraguay, and Brazil. We're excited to see where these graduates will go forth and teach. Graduates, we are so proud of you, and we celebrate this accomplishment with you. Congratulations. Sana Abdul Salam. Ayanna Cooper. Marcia Leite. Hyangmi Lim. Kalina McGilvray. Mihi Park. Tamara Peters. Renee Schultz. Christiane Somari Texeri de Lima. Priscilla Voloshin. Jillian Wewell. Graduates, we celebrate this accomplishment with you, and we welcome you to our body of alumni around the world. We look forward to hearing more of your adventures and want you to know it has been our honor to journey with you for this part of your travels. Congratulations to the Providence University College graduates of 2020 and 2021.
I never thought I would be a pastor. I never wanted to be a pastor. When I reflect back to when I started seminary to where I am now at graduation, I'm not even the same person.
Since 1972, Providence Theological Seminary has been graduating confident leaders who serve in their communities, local churches, missions, and ministry organizations around the world.
Now, as a full-time pastor, I actually feel continuing my courses has been really easy. Everything from learning languages to knowing how to exegete a passage, whether distance ed or online, this has been something that has partnered well with my full-time ministry. Even after I graduate, I want to be partnered with the seminary in continuing to help them, help me, help the church.
Dear board members of Providence University College and Seminary, dear President Dr. David Johnson, dear Seminary Dean Dr. Stan Hamm, dear faculty and staff, dear classmates and now colleagues, dear family members and friends, thank you for gathering virtually today and celebrating this important moment with all of us as seminary graduates. Dear classmates, dear graduates, I wonder how you must be feeling today. I have actually wondered about this over the past year since the pandemic started and everything changed. And all of a sudden, something was gone. Something that was very special to us. Things like talking before or after class, having conversations before or after chapel, seminary chapel on Tuesdays, or going down to the library and piling up books for the next paper. Having lunch together and seizing those moments to talk about ourselves, how we're doing, and about schoolwork and everything related to our classes. Tonight, however, we don't have to worry about that anymore. Tonight, there are feelings of relief, of thankfulness, and joy. Having achieved our master's degree is an accomplishment that is worthy of celebration and joy. Knowing that we're no longer looking at deadlines, at least not the way we used to, is rather relieving. And looking back at everything we've gone through and noticing God's presence through it all makes us grateful. Although we shared the same bench in school, so to say, over the past years, each person lived their own unique reality. There used to be an ad for a phone service provider in my home country, Paraguay, whose slogan read, "Cada persona es un mundo," which translates, Each person is a world. How true that is. Some of us came from another country. Some lived in different provinces. Some had to work while studying, while others were able to study full time. There's parenting, there are relationships with spouse, with friends, with family. There's church, faith, health, or health issues. So many things that were part of this chapter that we are finishing today. Each of us dealing with all these things in their own way, while also mastering homework, readings, papers, and so on, makes each person's life like a whole different world. Personally, I'm also grateful for the help I was given. To God, as He was in control over every bit, even when it didn't feel like it. Thank you, professors and seminary staff, for your support during difficult times and for being interested not only in our academic growth, but also in us as people. Thank you, dear classmates. I don't think I would be standing here today if it wasn't for you sharing your knowledge in class, for giving me advice and often good ideas for a paper that needed direction. Also for being the social support I needed in difficult times. Thank you. I'm also thankful for the support I got from friends and family, our adoptive family in Canada, our local church in Steinbeck, and last but not least, thankful for the support I got from my wife, Nancy. The mission statement of this school reads, Providence teaches people to grow in knowledge and character for leadership and service. No doubt has our time in school allowed us to grow in knowledge and in character. Our mission statement suggests this occurs in order to serve others. And specifically talking to the graduates of the seminary, no matter which track you were in, the result is to be better equipped to help others. And so, as we move on from Providence, as graduates, we commit ourselves to live out our calling to be servant leaders in the world. This is what Providence Seminary has prepared us for. This thought reminded me of a passage in the Bible where the author Matthew writes about Jesus' work. It says that as Jesus went through the towns and villages, he was speaking to the people and healing the sick. Then the passage reads, "When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, 'The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his field.' In short, there are a lot of people in need of help. In light of our preparation and helping others, as discussed earlier, I would like to encourage us all to help our neighbor, to help the one that is in need. May we serve others in our church, in our community, and beyond. May we serve and help others not only because it is our profession, but because it is our virtue as humans being created in the image of God. Allow me to finish with these words. Congratulations. You did it. We did it. Thanks be to God."
We would also like to recognize all of our seminary graduates today, including those who have earned a certificate or diploma. Well done. Dr. Johnson, the following candidates, having presented acceptable entrance requirements, having successfully completed requirements in the tracks of biblical languages, honors, English Bible, and having shown diligence in Christian ministry, and as such having completed the stated requirements of Providence Theological Seminary, are hereby recommended for the degrees Master of Arts and Master of Divinity.
By the authority of the Board of Governors of Providence Theological Seminary, and by the right of the Charter of the Province of Manitoba, I hereby present the degree Master of Arts and Master of Divinity, with all the rights and privileges attached thereto.
My name is Robert Dean. I serve as Associate Professor of Theology and Ethics at the seminary. Providence Theological Seminary offers a Master of Arts degree in a variety of specializations, including Biblical Studies, theology, educational studies, student development, TESOL, global studies, and youth ministry. The Master of Arts degree provides the opportunity for students to intensively engage their area of interest, while also providing the necessary theological breadth for graduates to thrive in their places of ministry and study. Members of this year's graduating class hail from across Canada and from around the world. Congratulations to the following students who are receiving a Master of Arts degree. Babatunde Adebayo, Brenda Allen, Isaac Daniel, Michael Fisher, Ram Hamoon, Yunho Jang, Rolf Cruz, Brad Robertson, Lulu Sangja.
It is my honor to congratulate you, the graduating classes of 2020 and 2021. You made it! You have finally reached that finish line that you have been pursuing for so long. Although I realize that each of your journeys to this point has been different, I'm imagining that for many of you, your journey has involved some or all of the following. First, saying no to invitations to spend sunny days outside with friends or family while you instead sit in front of a computer screen, keyboard, or plodding through that book you just gotta get done. Or going to bed way too late because of that paper that's due tomorrow that you just started working on today. Or anxiously anticipating that next client in your schedule that triggers all your insecurities and issues so that you desperately need to reach out to a fellow student or your supervisor to get that extra bit of calming reassurance. Or praying to God for strength, direction, and perseverance as you wrestle with faith issues that interface with this reality of people's sufferings. Or assuring your family and friends that after this one course, you'll finally be able to have some semblance of normal life with them again. Whatever challenges your journey has involved, today is a day to celebrate. You have persevered, and you have arrived at your destination. This is your day, and this is your milestone. And I am so pleased to honor you in this great accomplishment. I have been blessed to be a part of this journey, and on behalf of my colleagues, I wish you God's greatest blessings as you step forward into the next phase of your life and on whatever path God next calls you. Blessings to you.
Monica Benitez Friesen. Jillian Blomsma. Rosie Boscoyus. Juanita Birchby Martin. Heather Campbell. Angela Chan. Sylvia Chan. Kelly Cochran. Cheryl Dirks. Rhonda Dorn. D.L. Driedger. Adam Dick. Alyssa Giesbrecht. Lori Giesbrecht. Marlo Hebert. Darren Jones. Elizabeth Kale. Melissa Croker. Jacqueline Lotz. Daniel Lundy. Shreya Moroz. Stephen Neal. Cheryl Neville Cox. Marie Olson. Redeema Pinto. Lucian Sawatsky. Egon Sawatsky Friesen. Timothy Schellenberg. Alexandra Scivoletto. Carrie Seward. Nicole Steffens. Amelia Tomlin. Brent Thiessen. Derek Van Dalen. Kirillos Yunin. Sujung Yun. Pei Zhang. Jenna Zhao.
Hello, I'm the Reverend Dr. Lisa Ray Beale, and I'm the Old Testament professor at Providence Theological Seminary, where I also serve as the chair of the Bible and Theology Department. Today, it is my privilege to introduce the graduating students who have successfully completed their Master of Divinity program in the seminary. The women and the men who enter the MDiv program at Providence are prepared for various aspects of ministry in and for the church. Many of our MDiv students are called to pastoral ministry in local churches. Some are called to continue their studies at the doctoral level in Bible or theology, while some will express their pastoral calling through parachurch and chaplaincy ministries. The MDiv students that we honor today have entered and completed a program that has grounded them biblically and theologically, and throughout has sought to form them in spiritual disciplines. All the while, it has engaged them in the practices of pastoral leadership, so that our goal in the MDiv program is to help these students who are graduating to explore and to nurture their vocational identity. The students who are graduating have probably found an additional strength of the Providence MDiv program is that it has enabled them, if they need, to continue working while they pursue their education. And they're able to do that by the variety of ways that we produce classes. They're online, they can come through teleconferencing and modular or hybrid or a typical face-to-face semestral course. And that helps our students craft a program that meets their time and their schedule and their needs. Throughout all of the program, these students have been involved in pastoral contexts, enabling them to learn by doing as well as studying, so that they have gained an MDiv degree that has fully engaged their heart, their minds, and their hands. This year, I'm really pleased to extend congratulations to the following students who have successfully completed their Master of Divinity program at Providence Theological Seminary. Troy Dearborn. Andrew Dick. Sang Tech Chang. Philip Mantler. Christopher Smith, Brian Weeb.
Dr. Johnson, the following candidates, having presented acceptable entrance requirements, having successfully completed program requirements, and having shown diligence in Christian ministry, and as such, having completed the stated requirements of Providence Theological Seminary, are hereby recommended for the degree Doctor of Ministry.
By the authority of the Board of Governors of Providence Theological Seminary, and by the right of the Charter of the Province of Manitoba, I hereby present the degree Doctor of Ministry, with all the rights and privileges attached thereto.
My name is Dr. Stan Hamm, and I'm the Academic Dean of Providence Theological Seminary. I'm also the Interim Director of the Doctor of Ministry program. The Doctor of Ministry degree is the highest professional degree in Christian ministry offered by Providence Theological Seminary. The program is designed to assist in increasing the competency of Christian leaders so that they can achieve excellence in their current and future ministries. While this necessitates significant attention to theory, the end in view is professional. The program presupposes Master of Divinity studies and builds on biblical and theological foundations. It also utilizes the social sciences and related disciplines. The degree contains two tracks or areas of emphasis. One track is entitled Contextual Leadership and is tailored to pastors and ministry leaders in a variety of parachurch and other ministry contexts. Given the seminary's strong counseling program, Providence also has a second track called Counseling and Mental Health Practice. In both cases, the student receives the degree Doctor of Ministry. The area of emphasis allows the student to tailor the program more precisely. Congratulations to the following students receiving the Doctor of Ministry degree. Esther Boschman. Walter Johnson. Michelle Kaiser. Agatha Cole. John Tellman. On behalf of Providence Theological Seminary, we congratulate you for your accomplishments. It has been our pleasure to be part of your seminary experience. We are proud to welcome you to the Prov alumni family. We believe you will have a positive impact for the Kingdom of God in your neighborhoods and communities, in Canada and around the world. Congratulations to the Theological Seminary graduating classes of 2020 and 2021.
Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not, as Thou hast been, Thou forever. Faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto summer and winter and spring.
great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Let's pray. Lord, we come to you today and celebrate this special time with our graduating students, their families, and their friends. We thank and praise you for this opportunity to worship you. We thank you for the gift of life, the gift of salvation, the gift of calling, and the gift of looking to the future. We also thank you for your faithfulness in the lives of these graduates. We pray that you would give them wisdom to follow you into their different areas of work. Some will be going into further studies, while others will enter the occupations of business, science, psychology, church ministries, counseling, TESOL, parachurch ministries, and others. We pray that you would give them discernment as they seek to be wise leaders in this time, not conformed to this world, but transformed by your power. Lord, we ask that their hearts and minds would be open to your plans and purposes, and to be willing to go wherever you call them. Lord, we pray that you would also give them peace during these difficult times. Would their thoughts be filled with your strength and confidence, and not be drawn to worry and fear? May they experience your presence, and that out of their lives would flow love, generosity, service, and compassion in a world that needs your goodness. We pray that they would be strong and courageous as they understand that you have called them and that you are always with them. Would they stand up for what is right and have the boldness and courage to face the challenges that will come their way? May they stand strong and true, devoted to you and knowing that you have gifted and called them. Lord, we pray that they would have a passion to walk closely with you, that their hearts would be drawn to you as they walk in the presence of your Spirit. May they know the power of prayer and have a love and desire for your word. May you give them spiritual insight, wisdom, and deep understanding of your truth. May they know and experience your love, which passes all understanding as they walk with you. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
On behalf of Providence University College and Theological Seminary, I would like to thank you for having joined us today for this virtual graduation celebration. We are immensely proud of all that our graduates have accomplished, and we wish them God's richest blessing and presence as they move into the next stage of their lives, ministry, and vocation. Take care.
Congratulations, graduates of 2020 and 2021. Special shout out to the former graduates of Mile 2. I'm so proud and I'm thankful that I was able to start your journey with you. Way to keep following and not being just a fan.
Yes, I am still alive. It's been a sabbatical year for me. And like many others, I wish I could do this in person, but I would be amiss without saying congratulations to the class of 2021 and your fine accomplishments as you leave both virtually and physically at the end of this year. And so again, congratulations, and our paths will cross somewhere in the future.
Hi everyone. I've just finished telling Leo and Lila here all about your hard work, and they wanted to say congratulations. Well done, you've earned it. Enjoy your summer.
Grads of 2020 and 2021, you are our pride and joy, and you're the reason Providence exists as an educational institution. Now go out into the world and make it a better place. Congratulations.
What is your preferred writing stick? I like a pencil because I might be wrong and that might be messy. But you use ink to mark something that's final or complete. Grace and truth. You've learned both here, and my prayer is that you will have the wisdom to know which you'll need in the tasks that God is calling you to. But your certificates and diplomas, written in ink, well done.
Congratulations, Providence grads! And hey, at least you won't have to walk around and be seen in anything like this.
Congratulations, graduates, on a job well done. This is the fruit of all your years of hard work. You know, one thing about a virtual graduation is you don't have to worry about tripping when you go up on the stage.
Hi, I'm Grace Sandilak, coordinator of alumni. I would just like to say a big congratulations to all of you. All the hard work that you have put into is the culmination of this degree. I'm so proud of you, and I want to welcome you to the Providence alumni family. I look forward to staying in touch.
You're wrong.
I keep telling them that Virgil is the greatest Roman poet, but they seem to think it's Horace. Congratulations, graduates. A job well done. It's been great having you at Providence, and I wish you every success as you move on to the next adventures life brings. Cheers.
Grads of the Buller School of Business, congratulations. Go out and make your good mark on the world. And thanks for spending time with us and making some great memories.
Congratulations to our Providence Class 2021 graduate. I wish you all good luck into your new endeavors. Let this new journey be a success and a positive impact to your families and your communities in general. Well done.
Congratulations, graduates. You've reached an important landmark on your journey, but the adventure of discipleship continues. May what you've learned and experienced in our midst bless you as the adventure continues.
Grads of 2020 and 2021, woohoo! You did it! You finished. Against the seemingly insurmountable odds of COVID. Well, well done. Now, take what you've learned, go, and make this world a better place for everyone.
Hi guys, this is a great achievement. Congratulations. I am so proud and so happy for you. So now it's your time to go out there and show not only what you have learned in terms of acquiring new information, but what you have experienced so far all these years at Providence. And go there and be a difference maker. And don't forget us, come to visit us. We will miss you. And congratulations again. God bless you guys.
Congratulations, graduates of 2020 and 2021. It was virtually the best of times. It was the worst of COVID times. But through books and projects, papers and poetry, you made it to the finish line. I wish you God's blessings as you venture into the future.
Congratulations, classes of 2020 and 2021. It's graduation day, and I am so excited to see how far you come. It's been great to walk this journey with you, and I just want to say how proud I am of you for all your hard work and perseverance these last few years. Again, congratulations, and I wish you all the best on all your future endeavors.